The Apostle Paul is writing to the believers in Colossus. So we are in Colossians chapter 2, verse 1. For I would that you knew what great conflict I have for you and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. This kind of information that we find in the letters of Paul, you will not find it anywhere else in the books of the Bible. The Bible, the Holy Bible, the King James Bible, for the English-speaking people, is a big book, 66 books. You'll be pretty surprised to find that 95% of what is written in the Bible is not to you. It's for you to learn, to study, to understand, but not to you as instructions, and for your doctrine, for your instructions to follow. In fact, 95% is the prophetic ministry, and the number one subject is the nation of Israel. The nation of Israel of the past and the nation of Israel of the future. In the future, see these letters here, Hebrews, James, Peter, John, Jude, the Revelation. They are all to the nation of Israel of the future. So it's very, very, very wrong for anybody to take the doctrine from those books and apply it to you. Because here there is a condition of probation, not salvation. There is a condition that you got to believe, so you got to have faith in Christ, okay? But you got to do works under the law. And you got to persevere to the end. Now, if that would be the case for you and me, I can tell you, you know, without any shadow of doubt, wouldn't have any hope. No, because we still sin. When we get saved, in this letter here from Romans to Philemon, we are forgiven all our sins, we'll see now. But the sin nature is not eradicated. And that's the real problem. Because we are saved and we want to follow the Lord, Romans 7, we want to do the right thing because the Spirit now in us works for that. But we have a spiritual warfare with our own flesh. You know? And it's not easy because we don't have the Pentecostal power like the anointing, like, you know, Peter and James and all the others. We have the Spirit in us, praise God. You know? But not as the power to do those signs and miracles and so forth, and neither to make us walk in the ways of the Lord. That's going to be future for Israel. We were Gentiles. Here there are, in the letters of Paul from Romans to Philemon, is the revelation of the mystery, and there is more than one mystery. And here Paul is praying that the hearts of the Colossians may be comforted, receive comfort. Now comfort is very, very important when you are under stress, when you are confused, when you under you know the pressures of life, you need, besides other things, the comfort. In this case, talking about the comfort of God, of the Spirit, he's talking about the hearts. Hearts, of course, he's not talking about the physical heart. He's talking about the spirit of the believers, you know, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding. It seems very clear. It's quite evident, actually. Not seem, sorry. That God wants us to have a full assurance of understanding. Contrary to what people think, that God wants to kind of keep you in suspension. No, no, he wants us to know and to have a full assurance of understanding to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ. What does it mean? Well, the moment you really believe this gospel, for real, you know, not joking, not playing religion, you should come to this acknowledgement that God is one and is three persons. God, and that's God, the Spirit. And of the Father, you see the distinction. God the Father. And of Christ, God the Son, the Anointed One, the Messiah. The one in the middle, actually. The Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And it says here, in whom, Christ, you see connection here, are hid or hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Do we ever stop and think what an immense wisdom and knowledge the Lord has, the Lord Christ, because He created all things visible and invisible in heaven, on earth, in heaven, on earth, under the earth. All things visible and invisible have been created by the Lord Jesus Christ. So the measure, the amount of wisdom and knowledge of the Lord is mind-blowing for us, you know? And well, it says here, in Christ are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Do you understand, do you perceive our religion has been tricking you into make you believe a funny Jesus, you know, a Jesus, a picture, you know, a guy with a movie, you know, those movie in Hollywood, you see always this Jesus, like a hippie kind of type, you know, nothing against hippies, just to say, like a erratic, etherical, mystical, there's nothing to do. Christ as a man was a real man, and as a God, a real God, because He is true God and true man. Of course, the difference is He was not a sinful man, He never sinned. He never sinned all His life. He has been perfect. That's why the scripture tells us, Paul tells us, that God made Him, Jesus, to become sin for us, the sinners, so that we, the sinners, might become the righteousness of God in Him. My friends, my brothers and sisters, or friends, or even people that don't like me, fine, no problem. There is so much in this revelation of the mystery, in these letters of Paul, that you and I need to know, understand, study, to put our roots down in the reality, in the truth of the Word of God. And Paul says this, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Why? And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. There is always somebody, a man or a woman, out there to beguile you, which means to deceive you, to trick you, to bring you into a trap, spiritual trap in this case, with enticing words. Of course, the enemy, in his own evil ways, shows some clever ways, which are, he doesn't come like a monster, you know, to scare boogeyman, no. It comes with enticing words. So that's why you get new age. Thinking positive. Believe in yourself. And all you know, the religion connected with the other one I talk about too much. But the reality is, Paul says, I say this, I want you to know, to have a full assurance of understanding, acknowledging the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ, so you know in whom you have believed. It's not a joke. And in Christ I hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. So His power is overwhelming, you know, but it's real. And this I say, Paul says, I say this, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. And, you know, he said, for though I be absent in the flesh, yet I'm with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order, and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. Paul is very happy here because he said, I see that you are steadfast. Means steadfast, you're really, you got hold of it. You know, he's not just playing about, you know, like many people do. rooted and built up in him. So God wants us to say, like we have roots in Christ, and he wants us to build up. You know, the will of God for this, the dispensation of the grace of God, has been revealed and is clear. It's written there by Paul in other letters. God wants all men to be, he will, all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. So the action of God towards us, sinful men that we are, lost souls that we are, is he wants us to be saved. And once we are saved, he wants us to know the truth, but to know it in a way that we are rooted and built up in him. A slogan could be, souls saved and saints, believers, edified. Edified in the Lord, built up. That's exactly what it says here in Colossians 2:7. Rooted and built up in him. And please notice, established in the faith. Not established, but without the E. Established means you're stable. You are stable, you know. It is moving right, left, you know. Established. Established in the faith. The faith. We walk by faith, not by sight. But we are not the word of faith. Nah, forget all that junky stuff. We are members of the body of Christ. Members in particular. We are bones of his bones. Flesh of his flesh, the Lord Jesus Christ. We are the body of Christ. We are the church. The pillar and ground of the truth. Not because we've done something so extraordinary. Because we've been saved by grace. And the moment we've been saved by grace, having believed the gospel of Christ is death, burial, and resurrection. He died for my sins, all of them. He was buried, took my sins away. He was risen for my justification. The Holy Spirit of God has baptized us, or identified us, immersed us, what you want, in the death of Christ, in Jesus Christ, not in water. Water baptism is not for the body of Christ. It's for Israel of the past and the future. Anyway, rooted and built up in him, established in the faith as you've been taught. You see, that's very important. Many people say, I don't need to read the Bible. I don't need to study. I have the Holy Spirit leading me. You kidding me? We are not Israel. We haven't got that kind of anointing of which John here talks here. And we have the anointing. We need no man to teach us. We have the mind of Christ in the Bible. In the Bible, in the King James. When we study it, rightly dividing it, rightly dividing the word of truth, not just, you know, I just open the Bible and pick up anything. I open and it says, I got to go and build an ark. And you go and build an ark. And somebody say, are you crazy? You say, it's in the Bible. Yeah, it's in the Bible, yes, of course. It was to Noah, not to us. No flood of water is coming. Oh, I'm buying a shelter and filling with food. Why? Because it's written that the Great Tribulation is coming. Yes, it's coming. It's coming for sure. It will come. But not now. It will come after that the body of Christ gets taken out of this place. We meet the Lord in the air. When he calls his ambassadors home, of course the Great Tribulation will come. It's called Jacob's trouble. Thank you very much. You are not Jacob. You never were. You never are. You never will be Jacob. So if you are doing this, doing a shelter, because you read that it's about the Great Tribulation, you're showing me that you are not rightly divided the word of truth. You think to be somebody that you're not. You think to be Israel. Because they've been deceiving you in those denominations. I'm sorry, but the reality needs to be said. So, rooted and built up in him, establishing the faith as you've been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Why abounding? Because, you know, now that you're saved by grace, like you did nothing, Christ saved you by his death, burial, and resurrection. He did it all. All you can do now, for real, while you study, and prepare and understand the material, to be grateful, abounding in thanksgiving. Say, thank you, Lord, you saved me. Thank you, Lord, I'm not going to hell. Thank you, Lord, I'm saved. All my sins have been forgiven. And this is really important. Guilt can destroy you. I know. My life, I've been living in total guilt for years and years because I was in denominations. And they were driving a guilt trip every single time. And if you didn't do exactly the way they want you to do, ba-ba-bam, bashing right left and center, not necessarily physically, but with words that make you feel. Because if they make you believe that you're under the law, you finish, my man. You finish, because the law has got the ministry of death. Even though the law is good, but nobody can obey the law. Maybe you can obey one point, but what about all the other 612? Because there are 613 points of the law, and you don't even know them. By the way, we need to be taught, we need a teaching of the word of truth, rightly divided, and be grateful. Not as a legalistic way, I'm going to go to say, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you. Just realize, think, I've been saved. I was going to hell. I couldn't save myself, but Christ saved me. And all I had to do is just simply believe, trust this glorious gospel that he saved me by grace through faith, no works. It is the gift of God. Not by works, so no man should boast, Ephesians 2:9. Some people say it's the faith. No, that's Calvinism. The gift of God is this glorious salvation that you couldn't ever attain, has been given to you as a gift, a free gift. Oh, I don't like that. Oh, you don't like that God is good. I want to do something. Yeah, you can do something. Believe. If you want to do something that is not a work. Just simply believe what God says. Because you see, Paul, again, beware, beware. You know, when you walk and you see a gate, beware of dogs and guard dogs, and there are some tremendous dogs that are ready to devour you if you jump into that gate. This is a very strong warning. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. Wow. That's exactly the situation. Philosophy, vain deceit. Churches are full of them. Pastors, a Sunday after Sunday, they go there and they preach you from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, or the book of Acts, the first part, you know, all from prophecy, all stuff of the Old Testament. Yes, you got me. You heard right. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is Old Testament scriptures. Jesus under the law. Jesus came preaching under the law. He was a Pharisee. Well, not really, but he was teaching according to the law. According to the law. He didn't belong to the sect of the Pharisee. But Christ tells you and me a lot of stuff that we couldn't possibly do. In fact, he doesn't tell to us. He tells to Israel, to the little flock, to his nation. What would Jesus do doesn't apply to you. Doesn't apply to you. If you try to do what Jesus said to do in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you finish. You're going to hell. You can't do it. You just can't do it. Besides the fact that Israel stumbled and fallen. Read Romans 9, 10, 11. You'll find out. Anyway, I don't want to digress too much. Let's go back here where he says, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy, vain deceit. What? After the tradition of men. Mamma mia, you know. After the rudiments of the world. Ooh, rudiments. Even the word says rude, you know. And not after Christ. This is the answer of God to me and to you and to the whole world. Maybe I can speak English today. For in him, who, Christ, dwells, you know, dwelling, stays in, all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Now, the Godhead is the divinity, the Father and the Spirit and Jesus. In him dwells the fullness. You got Jesus? Now, I mean, wait a second. Doesn't mean you got Jesus. You believe that Jesus Christ is God, that is the Savior, and you believe what he's done. You're saved because of what he's done. You believe his gospel, right? The gospel of Christ, which is not the gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, is the gospel that he gave to Paul. You have the fullness. And good news. And you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Next time, some pastors or zealous denominational believer comes to you and say, you're missing this, you're missing, you don't do this, you don't pray enough, you don't read the Bible, you don't go to church, you don't pay tithes, you don't get water baptism, you don't do blah, blah, blah. You're missing this. Just say, wait a second. Let's go Colossians 2:10. You are complete in him. Can I ask you, which part of the world complete in him ye are? You don't understand? Which part? Is that difficult? Is that difficult? They make it difficult, the religious people. But it's very simple. You are complete in him. Because you're such a great saint. No, because he has made you complete. Because he put you in him. Do you understand? In Christ. Then there you are complete. Which is the head of all principality and power. The Lord. You know. You're not. But he is. In whom Jesus Christ, of course in Christ, also you are circumcised with a circumcision made without hands in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Now, here there are lots of words that people say, well, circumcision, what is that, circumcision made without hands? Circumcision means a cut. There was a cut in the flesh for Israel. There was a cut in the heart, spiritual circumcision. But there is another one. The circumcision of Christ means Christ as circumcised, as cut, as often away our spirit from the body of sins. That's the reality in which we live, our body. That's happened by the cross, by the way. By the cross. Not at the cross. Nothing happened at the cross. Nobody understood what was going on anyway. This young 33 years old, Jewish teacher, great man, prophet, oh yeah, everything you want. But nobody really believed, except a few, that he was the Messiah, like, you know, Peter and the 11, you know, the little flock. Anyway, nobody understood. And anyway, they all ran away. He was alone there. Nobody understood what was going on. But God knew. And now we know because he has revealed to Paul. That's why we know. That's why the churches are confused, because they take a bit of this revelation, a bit of the past, they make a nice mix, and you are in big trouble. Because if you mix law and grace, covenant and mystery, prophecy and mystery, Jesus' earthly ministry with Jesus' heavenly ministry, the revelation of the mystery given to Paul, you are in a big confusion. Buried with him in baptism. Once again, this is not water baptism. This is baptized into Christ, wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who will raise him from the dead. I got to stop because there is a lot of information here, my friends. I want you to get it bit by bit. I stop here, and I'll take up from this. Bye for now.